Some things about this course. This is a course for non-scientists. That portion of the enrollment policies is not a suggestion. I really don't want science majors in this class. If you are a science major, I'm going to notice, because that's one of the things that appears on the class list, what your major is. So don't take the course if you're a science major. Let me point out that, that freshmen don't have a major. So it doesn't matter if you intend to be a science major if you're a freshman. If you are a science major, I recommend Astro 210, which is being given this term. I have a little handout on all the different introductory astronomy courses at the front of the room if you're interested. Let's see. It is also true that this course is kind of intended for non-science majors who have a certain basic high school level comfort with sort of 10th grade science and math. If you're extremely phobic about these kinds of things, I would say that Astronomy 120, while it has a similar level of math, has a somewhat shallower learning curve and a somewhat deeper safety net. So if you're the kind of person who breaks into a sweat when somebody writes down an equal sign, check out 120. Let's see. But that's not the biggest difference between this class and 120. I think the biggest difference is what the class is trying to do. Astronomy 120 and also 110 and other courses in our department and elsewhere in the university are basically survey courses. Most introductory science courses are survey courses. They cover a fairly wide subject matter. This isn't that. What this course is supposed to do is we're going to talk about three particular topics in very considerable detail. Enough detail so that by the end of our discussion, you'll understand what's going on in current research in this topic. And by current, I don't mean this decade, I mean this week. Astronomy is currently in a stage of very rapid advancement. One of the things that's happened every time I've taught this course in the past is that at some point during the semester, someone will publish some piece of research which changes some aspect of the curriculum. I'll come in waving some paper and everything will be changed. I can't guarantee that, of course, because I can't predict the future, but it's happened every time in the past. So we really are trying to get you all the way out to the frontiers of the subject. I think this is actually a better approach for non-science majors. Because after all, we live in the internet age. If you want to find out a bunch of facts about some scientific topic, you can go online and go to Wikipedia or wherever and look these facts up. That's not a big problem. The problem comes when there are two sets of facts which directly contradict each other. This happens quite frequently in scientific topics these days, particularly those with kind of political or moral overtones. And you get facts that directly contradict each other. And what are you supposed to do about that? What I'm hoping is that by talking about situations in which the facts at the moment really aren't known yet, you can develop some skill in interpreting these kinds of contradictory facts for yourself. If you don't do that, then the only alternative is to listen to the experts argue with each other and vote for whoever argues the loudest or looks the best when they're doing it or has a degree from Harvard or whatever it is. You guys can do better than that. So the hope is that by practicing this kind of skill of evaluating science when the answer isn't fully understood, that you can develop skills that will stand you in good stead when you run into scientific controversies in a political context or a legal context or just as ordinary citizens in the course of your lives. It also happens that the three particular topics I think are of some real interest and importance in themselves. I'll get to the three topics again in just a moment here. But let me point out that this kind of approach has a downside to it, and this has been pointed out repeatedly on course evaluations. Because we're dealing with stuff which ultimately the answers are not yet understood, there's no textbook. There can't be a textbook. We haven't figured out what to put in the textbooks yet. And the problem with that is that that makes the lectures very important because that's the only information you're going to get. There's a whole bunch of online readings and stuff, but they tend to have a point of view. So it's really the lectures that are the basis of the course. The problem with that is that I've chosen to give this course at the ungodly early hour of 9:30 in the morning, and you guys are going to have to show up. And so here's the deal. I make a deal with you. Your job is to get to class by 9:30 in the morning. My job is to keep you awake once you're here. Okay? And so if we both succeed in cooperating in this sense, we'll probably be okay. But seriously, if you're anticipating regular difficulties in getting to class, this is not actually a great class to take because there's no backup in the form of a textbook. All right. The particular topics that are under discussion, I've listed them here in green. The first of them are extrasolar planets, by which I mean planets around stars other than the sun. It's well known that there are many, many of these planets. All you have to do is watch Star Trek or something like that, and you'll find many, many examples. And this has been a staple of science fiction for quite a long time. Oddly enough, until 10 years ago, there was absolutely no evidence for this. We assumed that because the star is a normal star and there are many other stars, the sun is a normal star and there are many other stars like the sun, that there must be many planets of the same kind as the planets in our own solar system circling around all these other stars. But until 1995, there was not one bit of evidence to support that idea. Since 1995, this has become a huge growth industry in research, and we now know of literally hundreds of planets, all of them discovered in the last 10 years. And so this is a situation in which what 10 years ago was science fiction has become science fact, and we're very rapidly trying to figure out exactly what kinds of planets these are, whether there are Earth-like planets out there, and that has some bearing on what the science fiction people refer to when they say as life as we know it. And so that's currently one of the hottest topics in astronomy. The next topic is going to be black holes, and this is a similar situation. 15, 20 years ago, black holes were sort of poised precariously on the boundary between theoretical physics and science fiction, a boundary that is more porous than you might believe. But again, in the past 15 years or so, this has been converted into a standard topic in observational astronomy. There are dozens, probably hundreds of objects we can point to in the sky and say, yes, those things are black holes. And so now the current topic of research is, do these things that we are pretty sure are black holes actually behave in the incredibly bizarre science fiction-y manner that the theoretical physicists have been talking about for the past 30 or 40 years? And so to what extent are these very exotic behaviors actually manifested in real life? Finally, I want to talk a little bit about cosmology. Cosmology is the study of the universe as a whole. That's too big a topic to go into in depth, so I've picked one piece of it. The piece I've picked is the existence, which was discovered in the late 1990s, of something called dark energy. Dark energy is an all-pervading anti-gravity. It's a repulsive force that turns out to occupy essentially all of the universe. And 75% or more of the entire mass energy of the universe turns out to be in the form of this mysterious dark energy. The evidence for this comes largely, but not entirely, from observations of a certain kind of supernova. And so what I'm going to focus on is the observations of the supernovae and how they demonstrated that, in fact, all ordinary matter and energy and so forth is a tiny fraction of what's actually going on in the universe. And what's really happening out there is something we totally don't begin to understand.